Hello, viewers. Welcome to Andynalysis. Welcome back, everyone, to my analysis of Ravel's Minuet in G from Le Tombeau de Couperin. This is the second video of that series, so if you haven't watched the first one yet, I highly recommend you to do that before coming back to this one. At the beginning of the last video, I mentioned that this composition is using a traditional ABA form as its structural blueprint. But there's a little, or actually quite a bit of a twist, as we shall see later on. For the B section, the second piece if you will, Ravel wrote a musette. The first part of the musette features a bourdon bass, bourdon being the French word for drone, referring to the constant pedalish sound. That was really funny for me to find out, because I had always thought that Rob Bourdon was a drummer. In terms of form, we've got 8 bars and an almost exact repetition, just a little change in the accompaniment. Cadential harmony is abandoned entirely. Instead, a parallel approach is used. The concept is, once again, parallelism. About halfway through the musette, the piece reaches a climax in terms of dynamics as well as harmonic density, before calming down again and leading to an almost exact repetition of the musette's A part. Let's hear how it sounds in total. And now let's have a closer look at how the climax is constructed. Why does this passage sound so dramatic? The most obvious answer, it builds up all the way till fortissimo. But it's also because of the melodic development, especially diminution, and lastly, because the D-flat slash G sounds very dissonant. Why does it sound dissonant? To put it simply, the D-flat triad contains the D-flat, which is a tritone from G, and the A-flat, which is a minor ninth. After all, out of all the intervals, those are basically the two most dissonant. Also, looking at the circle of fifths, we can see that D-flat major is the furthest possible way from G major. G obviously having one sharp, and D-flat having 5 flats, the result being a difference of 6 flats. In fact, the G major and the D flat major scale have only one note in common, and even that is not spelled the same way. To once again put it in jazz terms, in this G environment, D flat major is super outside. But how did we get ourselves into this mess to begin with? And how did Ravel make such an odd sounding chord sound kind of not that odd at all? The answer is once again parallelism. No, I'm just kidding. Here is what I noticed. The key signature of the musette has one flat, so it looks like F major, D minor. But seeing that there is a constant G pedal, I would rather call it G Dorian, a minor sound, but a rather bright one. We will see now how the color gradually goes darker. 16 bars later, we have an F minor over G, so a Phrygian sound. G Phrygian has 3 flats, so one could say we added 2 flats from G Dorian. And then, another 4 bars later, adding another 2 flats, we arrive at the D flat, so at, like I already said earlier, 5 flats. And, as the minuet ends in G major, and the musette starts in G Dorian, so a transition from 1 sharp to 1 flat, we see that the difference between those is also already 2 flats. Bottom line is, the effect of this D-flat slash G moment is so great, because that effect has actually been prepared very, very well. The preceding 24 bars have been leading up to it. Moving on to the next section. This is the mentioned da capo, but as you can see, there are in fact quite some differences. For starters, the melody is an octave higher, and the harmony is not spread between the left hand and the right hand, but is instead played almost entirely by the left hand. The harmonization is also quite different. Let's listen to those first couple of chords again a bit more closely. Now, haven't we heard this before? The main rhythmic figure of the musette has made its way into the recap of the minuet as the accompaniment for these first 8 bars. This is a clear indicator that we are in fact dealing with one continuous composition, rather than piece 1, separate piece 2, reprise piece 1. In the spirit of that continuity, the B part of the reprise is technically identical to that of the first minuet, but again, to add variation and make it more interesting, it is transposed a major third up. And lastly, I found this particular version of the 251 logo in the reprise. This E7 here has an added 9th, and it's actually a minor 9th, a flat 9. That's a pretty spicy and, sorry to repeat myself, jazzy color in this context.
Hey hey, it's me again. So, in this video series, I kept running into the issue of whether Ravel actively borrowed from jazz or not. I noticed that I couldn't answer that question here in the end, as it would need a broader understanding of early 20th century music in general. So that would be some nice input for a future video, I guess. However, I heard from different sources that jazz and classical music did in fact influence each other at that time. And I can't help but think that if that was so, it must have been a really creative period. I'm happy that also today I know quite some musicians from both worlds who are eager to learn from each other. And I noticed again that that is actually one of my main goals for this channel, to contribute to or even build a community of such open-minded people.
Thanks again, Meta Andy. Sounds like you had quite the epiphany there. So, the piece is over now, isn't it? We heard the minuet, the musette, and the reprise, so let's go home, ladies and gentlemen, let's go home. Well, yes, but actually, no. Because a serious piece of concert music wouldn't be a serious piece of concert music without a serious closing section, or, as professionals like to call it, a coda. So before listening to that and eventually closing off the video, the only thing that's left is a summary. How do I sound like Ravel? First, there's the old versus new aspect. Be inspired by traditional forms and make your own version out of it. In terms of harmony, use seventh chords, sometimes also with added ninths, and make use of the 2-5-1 cadence. On top of that, use suspended chords, pedal tones, slash chords, and non-functional harmony techniques such as constant structure. Use modes like Dorian, Phrygian, etc., and build a connection between two parts that weren't really connected before by having one overlap into the other, like we saw with the musette and the minuet. And lastly, of course, parallelism. And that's it for this one. A very special thanks to my brother for lending me his gear, and to my mother and the Trio Musikhaus Schenefeld for letting me record on their grand piano. Also, thank you to everyone who gave me feedback on the first video series that I made last year. I could already put some of it to use. One final thing about this piece. I spent a good deal of the first video discussing whether or not Ravel used 7th and 9th chords actually as those, standalone, or rather as suspended colors which eventually resolve. I'd like to direct your attention to the final chord. That should be very interesting. If you like this video series, please consider subscribing. There will be more of these in the future. If you made it until here, thank you so much for watching. It really means a lot to me. Be safe and hope to see you soon. Bye!